Well, we're having a good time, and we are in the Radio Entrepreneur Studios. My name is Jeffrey Davis, and probably one of the main reasons we're having a good time is we've been eating food that our guests have been bringing in, and I'm sitting with the one, the only, Peter Myerson. Hi, Peter.
Hi, Jeffrey. It's great to be here. The food's great, and I'm glad I'm just sort of sitting here munching.
Now, Peter, if somebody wants to read your book, how would they find it?
Well, they can find it on Amazon.
Okay.
I mean, all they have to do is look up my name.
Peter Myerson. Right.
And Heroes in a Different Time.
Right.
Or they can buy it from a company in Arizona, which, again, you have to kind of look on my website.
Do we have to turn back the clock to get Heroes?
That's really not the point of the book. The point of the book is that there are heroes in all kinds of times.
All right. Well, you're one of my heroes. My bar is low.
No, I'd say so.
Our next guest, Rick Porter, maybe a hero too. We'll find out in the next 10 minutes. President Cinch IT Worcester, right?
You got it.
Okay.
And one of the few that says it right. I usually get Cinch It, so... You nailed it.
Usually I get the right things wrong.
Yeah. Not this time. You got
it
right.
Not this time. So I'm a work in process, Rick. So tell us about Cinch IT.
We provide computer support to businesses. So everything from help desk to on-site support to cybersecurity software and strategic planning and consulting for businesses.
And that's a big deal today.
Nowadays, yeah, increasingly more and more important every day.
But very competitive, isn't it?
It is. It's competitive. It's competitive in a different way. So my industry is a wide range of companies. So you got everyone from the recent college graduate who went to school for computing that gets out and starts his own company right away. You got system admins that maybe were laid off and they jump into the world. And then you have people like myself who got into it as a business to help other businesses, and so they wanted to build an entire company, and they're looking for growth versus, you know, doing the technical work all day long. So it's a wide range. You got mom and pop shops, single companies, and you got large companies as well.
So let's. I'm sorry, Peter. You want to go first?
Yeah, I don't care. Sure. You know. So how did you get into it?
So I got into it right out of college. I went to school for business, and the first job that I ever got was actually at an IT company, and started over there. I went into sales with new business development and saw how quickly the industry was growing. Like you mentioned, technology becomes more and more important every day as businesses become more dependent on it. So it was an incredibly fast-growing business. Found out I had a knack for the sales side of it, loved the technology piece. Mostly really liked working with the businesses and helping them grow their business, become more efficient, more productive, and profitable at the end of the day through better technology. And decided after 3 years there, I was going to go off and start my own IT company. And that's kind of how I got into it. And from there, it's a long story of a million mistakes, and many of them probably repeated over and over and over again until it finally got through my thick skull and we've learned.
So... You know, how big is your company? How many employees do you have?
Right now we have 38 employees.
So it's a good size.
Yeah, it's not a bad size. So for an IT company, some would say it's actually a really big company. Because nowadays, you know, one technician can handle so many end users, right? So many computers. Because a lot of it can be done remotely nowadays. Last month, 96% of all the issues that my company resolved were done remotely. To have 38 people, just to think about the sheer numbers that they're actually able to manage and support, it doesn't take a lot nowadays. So it's actually a pretty good size company.
You know, that's interesting because I find I'm doing a lot more remote resolution in my business as well.
Yeah.
Peter, being a reformed attorney, that sort of that goes counter to, let's say, a productive law firm, solving problems remotely. Wouldn't you say that's sort of true, Peter?
No, I mean, I'd say the last 5 years.
Right.
Virtually nobody wanted to come into the office.
Don't take it personal.
I didn't take it personal. I was hoping maybe it was. I don't know. people really want to operate from their desk.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think it really matters what industry you're in. People are looking for ways, how do I put this, to be lazier every day, right?
More efficient.
You can use that word.
You're
we're going to cut right to it.
You're spelling bad.
But
you want to be
McDonald's,
more efficient,
right?
With your time. I don't even want to go to trade shows anymore.
Yep,
I can get all my information online, and I say to them, I don't need inspiration. I just need information.
You see it everywhere. If you can find a way to allow people, we'll use your word, to be more efficient,
right,
then you're going to make them happy. If you can help them out in any way make their life more convenient, they're going to be happy, and they're probably going to use your products or your services over and over and over. The funniest thing is, I don't know if you guys see these, even on Facebook, you get women used to have Tupperware parties and jewelry parties. They don't even get together and have a party anymore. It's a Facebook party now.
Right.
You get together and they talk about selling jewelry on Facebook.
They're taking away our likes, slowly.
I mean, at least I don't have 30 women in my house selling jewelry or Tupperware on the weekend. So I'm okay with this Facebook group. I like this idea.
So where do you go? I mean, how big do you get?
So we...
How long have you been in business?
So we've been in business since 2004.
Okay.
So that's we've seen an evolution. Yeah, yeah, we've seen an evolution and change. Interesting question you ask, how big can we get? How much do you grow? We actually launched a franchise program this year in 2019. So like I said earlier, we've made a lot of mistakes. We hopefully learn from most of those mistakes. And we have seen some pretty significant success. We made the Inc. 5000 list this year as well. And in the same year, we launched a franchise program. So we're actually opening up franchise locations eventually all across the United States. Right now, we're focusing on New England.
Are most of your clients in the Worcester area versus Boston?
So
how does your mix look?
Yeah, initially it was mostly out of the Worcester area. So I was born and raised in Worcester, started my business in Worcester. We've been there ever since the very beginning. So the core of the business is in Worcester. Naturally expanded over all of Massachusetts. We're now in Connecticut, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, Vermont, Maine. And then one of the main reasons we decided to franchise is our customers have seen tremendous growth themselves, and we've been able to support them along the way, and that's kind of forced us to evolve and grow as well. So, for example, I have a customer in Boston who buys a business in New Orleans, and they say, we'd like you to support them as well. I bring on a larger customer that says, I have 22 offices across the United States. And so we naturally have been growing as our customers have found success.
You know, I know this isn't in the proper sequence, but we're going to be doing some business shows in Central Mass, and we'd love to have you come to that as well.
Absolutely.
Because I would assume you still have a fairly large client base in the Central Mass area.
Absolutely. Yep. It's the foundation of our company.
Right, right. So Nathan will be talking to you about that show as well.
Sounds good.
That's very interesting. You know, viruses are just a ongoing concern for all businesses, and it's insidious. And what do you see coming down the road that we have to look forward to or not look forward to?
So I would actually say, not look forward to. I'd actually say viruses are becoming less of a concern, and now it's more creative threats. So viruses originally were the bane of your existence on your computer, right?
Well, it's more on my phone that's the issue now.
Yeah, that's exactly it. They're getting more creative, and now they're getting on your phone. Social engineering is becoming a hot topic. Social engineering, you'll actually receive a phone call. We've got clients that get...
I got one for a sergeant telling me that I needed to call the IRS.
Yep. And that's an actual... So I also serve on the board of the Better Business Bureau, so we see a lot of these scams that come through on a regular basis, and there are phone calls that come out from the IRS that says, hey, we have an issue. We're going to need this information. You'll get phone calls from quote-unquote Microsoft saying, please provide us with a password to your computer. We noticed that you have a virus on your computer. We want to clean it. It's going to be free, no cost.
Oh,
we
I've
just
gotten
need your password.
Some beautiful-looking viruses. Sometimes when I'm online, I get a pop. I have an Apple laptop right now. I got a beautiful notice from Apple.
Yeah.
I delete it. I've called Apple. They're like,
we
don't send pop-ups on your whole
screen.
Exactly.
And the IRS does not call you on your cell phone.
And then I
either.
Do a virus scan and there's nothing there.
Yep. Exactly.
It's gone. That's the beauty of it. They don't sort of live as quickly as long on your computer anymore. It's harder to find them. They're there. They're gone if they're not picked up.
Yeah. And the truth is that's the nature of the kind of the evolution of viruses. Fun fact. So here's your first nerdy fact of the day, and then I promise I'll try to leave out nerdy facts. Ready? Write
them down. Get your buzzers ready.
The first virus ever written was actually nothing more than graffiti. It was actually a virus that was written. It was called a creeper virus. And he actually was just tinkering around. He wanted to see if he could write a program.
This was a statement, not a question. I was ready. Okay.
Yeah, he wanted it. He wanted to get a virus that would actually go between terminals and leave a message that says, I'm creeper, try to follow me.
Right.
That was the first virus. It was
graffiti. I told you, Peter, don't go there.
Yeah. And believe it or not, the guy who created email was the one who really essentially created the first antivirus. And all he said was, that's really cool. I want to see if I can get something to follow it and remove it.
Really?
Yeah, and so it started as graffiti and fun, and then people learned how to make money.
I would have thought it was, excuse me, I don't want to get in too much trouble, pornography.
Nope. So
pornography really leads most industries when it comes to and that information.
You know, when you talk about pornography, then now you're talking about that social engineering part that I was talking about. A lot of us have seen that that FBI virus, or you may have heard about it, where you get a pop-up on your screen that says it's from the FBI, and it says, "Hey, we've hacked into your webcam. We see what you're doing online, and we're going to release that video if you don't pay $500."
Mm-hmm. Right? I don't get it a lot; only a few hundred times.
Yeah, you just keep closing
a few
it out.
Hundred
yeah.
times. Right.
So they're getting very creative.
And it's self-generated again. It's not up at my web host.
Yeah.
Because we use a web hosting service for my consulting firm. I go to the web host. That email's not there. Yep. It's coming out of my computer.
So are the protections that are being offered out there by various companies not effective?
So there's a lot of them that are effective. I would argue that they are very effective. So viruses per se, I would say, are not even a huge threat anymore. Antivirus programs are phenomenal. Malware is becoming more of an issue, right? The WannaCry virus, everybody's heard of that one. So malware, there's over 500,000 new malware programs are written every single day. And so it's hard to keep up with that. I think they do a very good job.
I didn't know there were that many people in the world.
Hey, if you're going to make money on it.
500,000?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. If you're going to make money on it, somebody's going to be out there trying to earn that money. And they do. But I think the antivirus programs, they do a good job. I think the biggest issue right now is training your people. But hands down, the biggest issue. There's not enough training done with employees on how to be aware or cognizant of that email that pops up, that's telling you, hey, I'm the CEO, please wire transfer $250,000 to this account. They're incredible.
Because we have Peter in chains, and if you want to get him out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everything I relate to you notice?
I had noticed. Sort of
you're trendier. He's getting
blamed for a lot here.
All my viruses have Peter a Peter guy. Connection.
No, you can't stop your employees from opening up porn sites.
Sure, well,
you can.
For the record.
You're the attorney. You could write a personnel policy.
Yeah, sure, but
there's technology that can also prevent that from happening. If you have a proper firewall in place, you can block websites like pornography. You can block social media. You can block gambling, job search. You can do any.
You got to hire smarter. Chris goes to websites he shouldn't go to, but they're usually around sugared drinks.
So
MSNBC.
Yeah. MSNBC.
Most of the hiring is being done on Craigslist, and right. It gets difficult.
He goes to pizza websites.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He just
sits there and looks at the pizza.
He
like Homer Simpson,
earlier,
and
he just
drools.
Started his diet. I understand.
No, but then he drools on his computer, and it kills the keyboard.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's pretty rough.
And then you get messages saying they're going to hold me hostage for a video of that.
For looking at pizza.
And then you're going to stay there forever.
Chris is one of a kind.
But before we go. So I hadn't really thought about this in the sense that...
Is it an inane question?
God, this must be really Peter... Get Peter Day. So the employers can write programs to stop their employees from using their computers in specific ways.
Believe it or not, it's actually a lot more simple than that. You don't have to actually write programs. Firewalls are in place where you click a button that says, I don't want anybody from my business using my internet, using my computers to be able to go to pornography, gambling, job search, Facebook, social media. It forces them to be productive.
But how does that firewall work? I mean...
So the firewall controls all the traffic that comes in and out of their system. So they have the ability to allow them to only go to certain websites when they're on their internet. They completely control their traffic.
Well, I'm going to talk over your head. So I think it's great that you are the fearless Fosdick for corporations. And Peter knows what I'm talking about. You don't.
Nope, not a clue.
Fearless Fosdick was a satirical rendition of Dick Tracy by Al Capp, the comic strip writer.
Got it.
Little Abner in the 1950s,
it's the first time
1960s.
I've been called that, so.
Well, Phyllis Fostick, look it up. You could put it on your website. You know, you can do something
it's
with that.
Love
it.
Great marketing
logo.
Tool.
It's a great logo. Phyllis Fostick was quite the guy. I liked him as a kid, but I just showed my age and Peter's even ager age. Rick, if someone's looking for you and Cinch IT Worcester, an unaffiliated firm that does what you do, and I think that's a good part we didn't get into, and we want you to come back. How would they find you?
Easiest way to get a hold of us is go to our website, cinchit.com. You can find all the information you need about any one of our locations. You'll be able to find the closest office to you. And we typically go out. Our first interaction is we meet with people and we do a free cybersecurity audit. So when Peter has questions like, can I keep my people away from pornography? We can answer those questions.
That's not Peter's question. It was, can I keep my wife away from my computer laptop?
Oh, that we can answer that question too.
Will it shut down automatically as soon as she opens it when I'm at the gym?
I hope she's not listening.
She's not. I hope. Hi, Judith. My name is Jeffrey Davis, and this is Radio Entrepreneurs. We'll be right back with more stories after this break.